This interview is made of Tom L. Wilkes, who now lives at 1311 Hargrove, Northwest Ardmore, Oklahoma. He is the owner of Wilkes Dry Cleaners on 9 North Washington.
I was born in 1883 in Pittsburgh, Texas. We moved to Oklahoma in 1894, and lived where 4th Avenue and C Street Northwest is now. At that time, we were in a big pasture that owned by B.F. Friendsley, and we had to have a fence around the place to keep the cattle out for a year or so. And then there were a few houses built along there, and after a while, the land was cut up into lots, and a few buildings were built there. And in 95, we had the big fire started in Harper's Livery Stable down on Caddo Street, where most all of the fine horses and the express company's horses were stabled, and they burned up something like 100 head. And the entire town burned up, except where the little builder, in that block that stands now, all the rest of the buildings from the First National Bank East, that was as far as the main, as the business district ran then. They from the First National Bank now, west was residences on each side of the street. The main part of the business was down across the railroad, known as the Iron Store, owned and operated by Munzenheim and Zugerman. They carried on and they furnished all the people in this trade territory of about 100 miles their provisions, carrying on ranches and food and clothing. They fitted out a family for the year. They came in the fall and they sold their wares and took back their supplies, and they didn't come back to town again until next year. And then they Zugerman's passed away and Dalby's took it up. Dalby's of Munzenheim and Dalby. And after Munzenheimer passed away, Westheimer took it up. And the Westheimer and Dalby moved across the railroad just west of the Frisco track and called it the Blue Front. And they had acquired a great deal of land and cattle and things, and they finally built this, my father having built the building where they have now, in 1911, and they moved in there and put in one of the finest stores in the southern part of Oklahoma, which we still have. And they, about 1900, I went to work for friends in Sibley on the ranch, now known as the Chapman and Cornell Ranch. We controlled the entire top of the mountain over there from Honey Creek, known as the John Washington Ranch, back to the railroad. Sibley lived where the Cornell headquarters are now, the old Moss Patterson headquarters. And we went up through there, through the cut of Buzzard Springs, with wagons hauling supplies and things in there, with from 4 to 6 mules. That's the only way we could get on top of the mountain with any kind of provisions and things. And the Jennings's ranch was west of us that raised horses. They raised a fine breed of quarter horses. And the ranchers bought these horses because they had the stamina and the bottom. They're the best horses that ever bred in this country. Royer Ranch was on west, known then where the Fitzgerald Ranch is then, where the Fitzgerald Ranch is now. And they had a big spread up there. And Joe Mix was the foreman with the ramrod for Royer. Bill Chapman's ramrod for Spencer Sibley. George Corn run what we call the cattle headquarters. We brought the cattle off at the top of the mountain in the wintertime and brought them down to the breaks and fed them through the winter hay. We took them off there because the cold weather at that time was so much colder than it is now that cattle couldn't survive up on that mountain without a lot of feed, and so we brought them down in the breaks and kept them in there. And cattle then that we had was longhorn mostly, and Texas steers, longhorns that they've never been bred up. Bob Gillum, known as Scrub Bull Bob, and about 1906 started out with a program to swat the scrub bull. He and Mr. Tom Dunn were big landowners at this time. They went out and they bought a lot of fine breed of bulls and brought into this country here and got the people to realize that the scrubs that they had wasn't doing them any good. So if a man couldn't buy one, well, they'd let him have it and he could pay whatever he could for it. So they built up the breed of cattle. Eventually, his friends and servants brought the white-faced cattle in. They were long, they had horns, and the meanest, fightingest darn cattle on earth. But they finally kept them dehorned back, and the breed of cattle now don't have too many horns. Most of the white face have very short horns, if any. And all the ranches took up this finer breed of bulls and thing and bred their cattle up to what it stands now, which is the best cattle, I think, on earth, is the white face cattle. Well, in the early day, Bill Washington, down in Love County, had a big place down there. In fact, he had about all of Love County. He moved his cattle to the Osage Hills, the Osage country up in the old Indian Territory, or old Oklahoma, in the bluegrass strip up there, and he'd drive them through and pasture them up there till they got fat, and he'd take them to Wichita and sometime to Abilene, Kansas, to the railhead. And I happened to ask Bill one day, what was the biggest herd he ever pushed through? And he said, well, he put 10,000 head at one time, and he thought that they were about 1906. Well, I said, I saw those cattle go through, Bill. It took 2 days for them to go by. Well, he said, that was the bunch. Now, they usually took about 5,000 head or something like the smaller bunches, but this time he had an unusual lot of cattle, and he wanted to get them all into Wichita, Abilene for the market the next fall. Those cattle went through early in the spring, and it sometimes took as much as 3 months for them to push them up to the Osage, and then they'd stay on that blue stem grass till long late in the fall, and they'd move them in there then fat, and they'd put them on the market and bring a good price. Cattle then brought from 17 and a half to $20 a piece. Old Bill said, well, every time a cowboy would drive extra cow in, I'd give him a dollar. I always carried a saddle pocket full of silver dollars. And he said, sometime I'd run out and I'd have to go to the bank and get me 300 or 400 of them to give the boys, to pay the boys that brought the cattle in. Well, there's open range, nobody, there's cattle that nobody knew who they belonged to. And they drive them through here, they cross the Canadian up here about Lexington. And they'd have some time to wait there for quite a long while on the order of that quicksand. They finally got a remedy to that. They'd put the horses across first and then put the cows on. The horses' hoof would pack the quicksand down, the cows would go across. I was working for Bill Tyler when they found that out, and he said that he was driving with Jess Chisholm. He was riding a trail and a herd to Wichita, and they got up there and they got to the Canadian. And old Jess was about a half-breed Indian, and he was pretty foxy about that, so he put his horse across the Canadian, and the horse's hoof packed it down, and then the cows all went across, and old Jess established the Chisholm Trail. And that's way back there about the first trip they come through was about 1900 when they went in there. But Jess Chisholm drove lots of cattle through this country. He was west of here where the old Chisholm Trail is marked off now. But Bill Merritt worked for him and drove through from all of Texas. And Jess Chisholm was the greatest trail herder, I guess, of that day, because he got through regardless of the Indians, cow thieves, cutthroats, and everybody else. He made it on through. He never did lose anybody's herd of cattle. Now, those people down there pay him so much ahead to take those cattle to Wichita and to Abilene. They went to Abilene most of the time. They'd take them into Abilene. They finally got a train, a railroad in there, and old Jess never lost anybody's cattle as long as he was driving that trail herd through, trail them through there on the Chisholm Trail. Now we can cut her off. Let's see what we got. In about 1911, they discovered the initial well in the Healdon Field. The people that were back of that was Bert Franklin, Sam Apple, Roy Johnson, Ed Galt, P.C. Dings, and Bert Simpson. Old Captain Cook and Red McGee Well, the boys, the geologists on that well, there was a couple of rock hounds that people didn't have much faith in, but they went out there and they staked a claim, a lease, and they got some company to drill it in, and they stayed on that night and day, and they finally drilled this well in. Well, the Hilton Field was born, one of the greatest fields in the oil industry today, because it's lasted longer. That started in 1911, and it's still producing on those same wells are producing today. Hilton was just a small country town there, and Jake Hammond and John Ringland built the Ringland Railroad. And they didn't go to the old Hilton, they missed it, and they built the new Hilton. And they went to Ragtown. Well, Ragtown was about 2 miles west of Hilton, and they said that was the toughest place on earth. The people that come from the Pennsylvania field, the drilling contractors and oil men, said that they never saw anything to equal with thugs, thieves, every kind of a person on earth all flocked there. Well, I happened to be out there one day and saw 7 fights at one time. And I got quite a kick out of it, because it was a man's fight then. They just a fist and skull fight, and nobody interfered. If he did, he got whooped himself, maybe. Buck Garrett and Bud Blue were the, they tried their, did their best to keep law and order in that field out there and keep down as much crime as they could. And Hilton Field still produces, and all around there, the different fields have sprung up from then, and there's been jillions of dollars taken out of those fields in oil in Carter County. I don't guess there's any way to estimate the entire total amount, but it's been quite a sum. And the people of Carter and Ardmore have enjoyed that, because there was a world of those people that bought royalty and places and owned land and things that they didn't ever think would be worth anything. It's made them rich. And there's more millionaires in Ardmore than any town in the United States that's its size today. Now let's see what cut that. September the 27th at 2:27, there was a carload of gasoline or nitroglycerin exploded down on the, they called it casein head gas, on the Santa Fe Railroad. It killed 43 people and wounded about 400. It blew all the windows out of the buildings, blew most of the buildings down, blew the fence in. And they blew all the power lines, gas lines, and everything was blowed up, and we was in darkness here for a week, and we didn't have any gas for till the people could make the proper connections and inspections to see whether it's dangerous to turn it on or not. And out of that, Santa Fe came down here, Mr. E.P. Ripley, with the assistance of Mr. Taylor, which is both deceased at the time. They come in here and they made a survey of this situation from Chicago. Mr. Ripley said that they'd assume the entire responsibility. The citizens, the mayor appointed a committee to check the claims and find out the damages done. And the railroad company, they appointed their committee, and they came down here and they worked in harmony and they figured out these things. And there was a few wildcat lawyers that got in after it. And they made a lot of niggers believe that they'd all get rich if they got a little scratch of the front porch blowed off of the house. But it was all worked out, and there was only one person, I think, on one lawsuit out of all that. And Mr. Ripley stated that there'd been over $1 million spent in rebuilding this entire town, we might say, that they sent Mr. Taylor, which is assistant manager and was then, up till his decease, was a superintendent of the Southern Division, headquarters in Fort Worth. He said they spent over $1 million getting the people back where they were and keeping Ardmore from being totally bankrupt, because the people had no insurance like that to cover those losses, and they were helpless. The town was small, and they wasn't able to replace those things, so we'd have just been a ghost town in a short time if it had not been for the railroad. And the Santa Fe Railroad did all of this for the people without one murmur. And the people of this whole southern Oklahoma certainly owe the railroad and the president and the officials of the railroad a debt of gratitude for being as kind as they were. And we still stand by the Santa Fe. That's for that. We'll talk about Ardmore, because I think Ardmore is the best town in the United States. I like it ever since we've been here, if I hadn't have left here, but it's always been good. Ardmore's made progress. It's been making a slow progress, but now it's just got growing pains all over us. We're bonded, building and building and building. We built out here in pastures that we didn't have any idea that there ever would be such a place as a residential district out in the north part and the southwest part of town. There's been some of the finest homes built here of any town like this in the whole country. And they're still going, and we are still expanding. We have a wonderful air base up here that gives us a pretty good boost. And we've got a lot of fine people here that's with the air base, and we appreciate those people being here, and those people are helping make it possible for our town to grow. We're having a little water shortage. I haven't been on the planning committee of this water situation and the planning board, and we've been making a survey of our water here, and it's a little bit critical at the time. However, we can get water if it's necessary, because I never saw Ardmore fail to come up with something yet. We've been in a lot of pinches. We can get the water, and we are turning the water over from Ardmore Lake at the Club Lake and let them have, and there's about 40 to 50 days of water there, and then we have about 70 to 80 days there, and by that time, well, I know we'll get a rain. If we don't, well, we'll tap Lake Murray or Texoma, and we'll have plenty of water for the people here, and there's nobody to get excited about it. And the town is continuing to grow, and we're doing a wonderful job of paving and resurfacing all the streets, which adds to a progressive city. And now we're working on some different things about the city, and I think by the time we get those, all this planning board gets worked out and gets the cooperation, why, well, we've got to make a lot of bonded expansions for more water and more sewerage lines, because we have just about reached all the outlying district with sewer that we possibly can without getting into it with an extension on the water and sewerage lines, which costs a lot of money. We don't owe too much money on a town of this size and the rapid progress that they're making. A town of 30,000 and they owe about $3 or $4 million, not too much money for this place. So we'll have to keep on going if we bonding the town, if we expect to keep on expanding. We're essentially located between Oklahoma City and Fort Worth and Dallas. It's getting to be the central shopping point here for about 100 miles each way, east and west. And we're pulling in from the north and the south on a radius of about 50 miles, like Paul's Valley and Gainesville and places like that. A lot of good stores here. The people here have gone forward with the stores as well as any other place. We have some store here as a credit to any place. The new Safeway is one of the outstanding and Humpty Dumpty stores, and we have some local food stores here that excel by none. And they would not have come in here if they didn't believe in the progress that Ardmore was making, and making it so that it would be a substantial firm's foundation which they were building it on. So the Safeway and the Humpty Dumpty don't jump in and spend $500,000 or $750,000 on something they don't figure out before they do it. So it gives us a lot of encouragement to go ahead and expand and know that we're going to have a large town and a good town. We're building new schools. We're going to build some more new schools. We have to keep abreast with the school situation if we ever expect to do anything. So we're building the schools too. Just finished one in the north part, and I'm building another one now. Makes three ward schools in the north, in the first ward. So we've got about one or two more schools, one down in the southwest and one in the west. Up here would be in the third ward and another extension in the first ward. Now we've got on the committee that's working on the fire extension, we've got two proposals to build a fire station in the north part of town and one in the west part of town. It's something like 2.5 miles from the central fire station to the outlying districts in the north part of town, and that's just too far for fire trucks to run. The house would be demolished before it ever got there. And in the southwest, the same thing. So this planning committee's record requested the city to put in more fire stations and revamp the ones we have and move over the one in the second ward back out far enough so that it can reach a lot more territory at a shorter period. And and keep beyond the railroad tracks. We almost have to have a fire station in there because the train sometimes ties up that we couldn't get over. That house is lost. Now, Cutter.